I'm really loving The Birth of Tragedy right now by Nietzsche, because he believes that Euripides and Socrates killed true art because they focused so much on logic, whereas before there was a line of demarcation and straddling the dichotomy, the collocation and juxtaposition between Apollonian way of doing art and also the Dionysian way of doing art. Now, Apollos, as you may know, was the Greek mythological god of reason, of light, of the sun, of order, but then Dionysius was the god of wine, the god of madness, and the god of chaos. And Nietzsche believed that in order to produce a magnum opus, tour de force, and PSA de resistance, you have to straddle the line between the touch of madness and the wine god, but also the logic and the reason of Apollos, and that's how you're going to create great art, which is really good advice. Like Kerouac, you got to know the rules of grammar in order to break them. Like Picasso, you've got to master Raphael at 16, and then you can break the rules. Or Kerouac, you know, putting periods in random places. Isn't that crazy? So I think that's a good way of doing art. I really do. I think that's a great way of creating. Now, this line of demarcation between Apollos and Dionysius, this wasn't new. This had been talked about before, but where it was new is he argued actually Socrates and Euripides in their way of overly going into Apollos' logic and reason killed the madness and the chaos. And that's why Nietzsche was a disciple of Dionysius. He was a wild man of the cave in the Thus Spoke Zarathustra Übermensch sense. And he went mad when he saw a man beating a horse, and he said to the horse, "I understand you went crazy for 10 years before he died." That was Nietzsche's story. But like, he was bringing a new twist on an idea that had already been propagated. And that's what I always want to do. I want to bring a fresh twist on obscure ideas that may have been propagated, but give my own original idea to that. And that's where originality truly comes from. So be that as it may, in this book, he has an incredible way of explicating what it looks like to find yourself in the madness of the despair, which seems to run the order of the day. Now, here's what I mean. He tells this story in the book, The Birth of Tragedy. He tells this story of the fabled King Midas. Remember, the Midas touch, everything he touches turns to gold. Midas is in a forest and he's hunting for one Silenus. Now, Silenus was the tutor of the wine god Dionysius in Greek mythology. And he's going looking after this demigod, Silenus. Silenus, this demigod. And when he finally gets him into his proverbial hands, obviously not his physical hands or he would have turned him to gold, but he finally apprehends this demigod, Silenus. And in so doing, he says, what is the most desirable fate of man? What is the most desirable thing a man can possess? And immovable and without flinching, unflinchingly, Silenus, this elderly tutor of Dionysius, says to King Midas, "Oh, ephemeral and miserable race, succumbing to sadness and chance, you want to know something that is not expedient for you to know, because if you want to really know what is the most desirable thing for man to possess, that is non-being, to never have been born, to not exist." That's a very anti-nihilist thing to say. Chiorn would agree, the trouble with being born. But be that as it may, he says to never have existed. But since you can't do that, the second best thing you can do is to die quickly. Like, how depressing is that? And today I was at the beach and like I saw this bird die. And it was so sad. I thought it was just chilling, enjoying its time, but I literally watched it die and I was just petting it as it passed away. And it was absolutely heartbreaking to watch this bird die. And sometimes you see things that are tragic and you just think, man, everything is succumbing. You know what runs the Apollonian order of the day? It's the Dionysius chaos. I've never heard it said that way, but if that's what life feels like sometimes. And in those times where despair seems to run the order of the day, you go into the ocean. For me, that's huge for me. Like, you know how the ocean has the same concentration of salt to water that you have, that a mother has in her womb? So the same concentration of salt to water is the same as that in your mother's womb. It's also the same as your tears. That's why you can open your eyes underwater and it's actually not bad for you. Although I always open my eyes underwater, but I'm specifically talking about a clean ocean. When I'm in the ocean, I was doing a night swim next to the pier tonight, to the buoy and back, and I'm just like, I'm seeing the lights glisten off the waters and I find meaning again. Or I am with my cat, Mr. Fridge, as he's sprawled out on the bed, taking up like, he just will take up huge space. Fridgy, somebody called him Toast the other day. Somebody called him Toast, but I'm with my cat. Or I'm meeting new people and forging meaningful relationships and friendships and finding someone to love, courage during suffering, finding work that I find meaningful. That's Viktor Frankl's logotherapy. You got to go back to those times where you're ensconced by the beauty. You know, immersion, you know, Michael Phelps didn't take a day off for 5 years. I actually didn't take a day off for 5 years either, but from being, he was in the pool every day. That's how he won the Olympics. But there's something about immersion. He has mental health problems, depression, just like I've been open about my problems with that. And my therapist said there's something about immersion, like going full on in the water, that's really helpful. I find healing there. But it's not just that. Like, remember the learned astronomer, Walt Whitman? He's like, I went to the learned astronomer and he was telling the lecture all about the stars and the science of astronomy. And it was correct technically, but it made me tired, weary, and sick. And with his existential nausea, he went out to the moist night air and he looked at the stars. And that's how the poem ends. Isn't that great? You go look at the stars. You go experience the stars. You go experience meaning. Sometimes you got to get out of your head of logic, which will, remember, it was Euripides, it was Socrates who killed the madness of Dionysius in great art. Sometimes you got to go back to the madness. You got to experience the beauty. You got to ensconce yourself, make it tactile, make it pragmatic, gnosko, something you know firsthand. That's what you got to do. And then when you do that, you not only create great art, you yourself are the recipient of the experience of art and in turn anthropomorphize, personify, and flesh it out.